Hi, my name is Gabriel and you're watching Eco Diaries. It's the second part of the movie 10 Ongoing Environmental Conflicts with the next 5 stories about the fight, risks, losses and victories of environmental defenders around the world. If you skipped the first part, don't forget to watch it as well. Before we start, I just want to remind you that recently Global Witness reported the rise in deadly attacks against environmental defenders in 2019. We lost 212 people who had the courage to try to eradicate deforestation, land grabbing, pollution, poaching, and illegal mining. What thrills me most is the fact that environmental defenders are usually demonized, saying that they're against economical development or further prosperity of the country. But practically, they're the one who thinks about future and the next generations. And their stories must not be silenced. That's what we're doing right now. Please share this video and keep spreading the word about environmental defenders who fight for our tomorrow.
Imagine that you have in your house your animals, your family, and these people come to your house and say you need to sell your house because we are going to do mining here. Imagine that you lost everything. You have the only option is to go and to protest. About 25 years ago, the effects of the policy on economy opening began to be felt, but the communities of Soto Norte in the department of Santander here in Colombia have lived by artisanal gold mining since the colonization of the Spanish in the 16th century. After the arrival of multinational mining companies from other countries to Soto Norte in the 1990s, local inhabitants began to sell their mining titles, paving the way to the development of the large-scale mining projects. And at the same time, nationally, between 1996 and 2001, the mining law was reformed with the technical assistance paid by the Canadian International Corporation, and they opened new areas to mining activity. We realized that the people that doing illegal mining, it's because they don't have other option. It's because they have been doing this since many years. But the people that have those big companies that come here and they have all the license and they are destroying the planet. Páramo ecosystem has an incredible biogeographic, socioeconomic, geological, and ecological unit that nature has developed over millions of years. Páramo's ecosystem in Colombia corresponds to 2.5% of the national territory. They participate in the water regulation of the country. These niches provide 70% of the water to the Colombian population. The Páramo de Saturbán is a high mountain ecosystem. Imagine a mountain, and the government wants to say that a part of the mountain, this is not the mountain, this is for the mining, and the rest of the mountain is a mountain. But what happens if you do mining in a part of the mountain? Obviously, you're going to affect all the mountain with the years. They use in mining a lot of chemicals. There are some chemicals that are very bad for the water. What happened is that they use those chemicals to do mining. The water that is underground, these chemicals, they dissolve into the water and contaminate the water. And this water is the water that the people need to do a soup, to do food. This gold mining is bad for the environment, and more if it's larger scale. So it's a problem that we need to resolve now in order to protect people and protect nature for the future. The role of the government is very important because when we're talking about existing of mining titles, mining contracts, mining concession, large-scale mining, realize that the priority of the state is to make easier to the multinational to operate. It's persecutes to the small miners because obviously they want job and they lost the job, they lost their houses, and they are angry. But when they are protesting, when they are talking, when they send, you know, papers to the government or the documents saying, hello, I lost my job, I lost my house, what is going to happen to me? We don't need these people that are from other countries here because it's our place, it's our mountain. They persecute these people and it's something dangerous for these people. The governments, in most of the cases, give the license without talking to the community. This community, they don't know why they are there, why they are taking houses of the people, why they are killing people, why they are using the nature resources for their company. They don't know what happened because the speaking between the community and the government doesn't exist. The mining in Páramo de Santurbán, they don't start. First, they need the license in reunions, talking about if they are going to give the license to Minesa, that is the company, or not. So that's why we are doing a lot of investigation, a lot of trending topics in Twitter, a lot of videos in social medias, because we need to make the government not to give the license. Actually, this is the problem, that now we need to say no to the license to Minesa. Every year with the largest demonstration with the slogans, Minesa de Santurbán out, our world is water, water is life, no more name lovers and deception. We did a paro nacional. It's like a big march, a big protest against all these people that want to destroy the places. And there are people that live there. There are people that work. They don't have money. They love their jobs. And the only thing that they can do is to protest. Being a defender here in Colombia, it's so dangerous, but it's so patient and so beautiful. All of those men and women are who are aware of the need to protect the environment, common goods, and the collective rights of citizens for the benefit of future generations. Some of them are normal people from the community. Some of them are, for example, politics. The problem is that the government needs to find a solution to protect these people. For example, here in Colombia, there is a document that is called Acuerdo Escazú. And it's like the Paris Agreement, but the Escazú Agreement is only for the defenders. I think that Colombia signed, it signifies that they are going to invest and they are going to defend the people that are in danger because they defend the nature. There are a lot of people that are defending the nature. It's dangerous because there are some people that have the vision that we are danger. Some people think that we are the defenders, we are the heroes, but for other people, obviously, they have other vision of us. They think that we are going to close their companies. They see Colombia as a bag of money. They see places where they can destroy and where they can do mining, where they can do livestock. But we see our life. We see the place where I have my house. I live here. Colombia is not only money. In these places, we have culture, people live there. people have their children there, people work there, and the government needs to understand that we need to defend Colombia as a place that have all this diversity that is very important to protect. I can't wait in this seat and doing nothing. If they kill someone, this is going to be another reason to continue fighting, to continue defend the nature, to continue defend the natural resources. We continue in the fight. We continue, obviously, very carefully in this fight, whatever we can do, if we can do a strike, if we can do a protest, we do. In every place, you can be part of the change, you can be part of the transformation, so it's something that we need to do.
Quiero dejar este mensaje en español porque me parece muy importante. Todas las personas de Latinoamérica, en verdad, sigan luchando. Yo sé que somos personas muy fuertes, hemos sufrido bastante y yo creo que ya es hora de despertar y de hacer algo. Todas las personas jóvenes que están viendo este documental o que lo van a ver, gracias por estar aquí. Gracias por ver este tipo de información que es verdaderamente importante. Los apoyo totalmente. Fridays for Future Cali los apoya totalmente en todo lo que hagan. Si hay también Fridays for Future en sus países, muy bien, continúen haciendo strikes todos los viernes, continúen luchando, continúen viviendo, continúen informándose. Porque todos nosotros los jóvenes, los que estamos haciendo esto, en realidad vamos a ser como el futuro de la población, el futuro de la sociedad, y tenemos que cambiar de muchas maneras estas situaciones que estamos viviendo. Así que, Faichi, gracias, gracias a todos.
У нас в регионе, в Кемеровской области, сейчас идет массовое открытие угольных разрезов, то есть добыча угля идет открытым способом. Добыча угля открытым способом – это наиболее экологически вредно по сравнению с добычей угля закрытым способом, то есть в шахтах. От этого идет загрязнение рек, почвы, а также угольная пыль выбрасывается в больших количествах в воздух, которым дышат люди. И распространяется на десятки километров. На юге Кемеровской области проживает народ шорцы, а на севере телеуты. Так как разрезы в основном открываются на юге Кемеровской области, то больше всего страдают шорцы. Когда открывается разрез там, где живут шорцы, то их вынуждают продавать свои дома, тем самым традиционное природопользование шорцев страдает. Шорцев становится все меньше. Любой малый народ существует лишь тогда, когда есть его культура, язык. Например, был поселок Казас. В 2013 году угольная компания «Южная» подошла вплотную к этому поселку. И поселок мешал добывать уголь. Тогда жителям было предложено продать их дома. Те жители, которые не согласились, их дома сгорели. Кто их поджег, до сих пор следствие не установило. Также жителям этого поселка впоследствии был затруднен доступ к кладбищу их предков. Чтобы доехать до кладбища, где похоронены их предки, они должны были проезжать через контрольно-пропускной пункт угольной компании. Их автомобили досматривали. Один из коренных жителей, Яна Танагашева, она поехала в ООН, там заявила об этом.
В моем регионе, я считаю, происходит этноцид по отношению к моему народу. создаются такие условия, в которых жить невозможно.
После того, как она выступила в ООН, где заявила о этноциде ее коренного народа, после этого началось сильнейшее давление. И она вынуждена была вместе с мужем и детьми покинуть страну. В Новокузнецком районе есть такой поселок Черемза. Это маленький поселок, где проживает менее 100 человек. Возле этого поселка угольщики захотели построить углепогрузочную станцию. В декабре 2019 года были проведены общественные обсуждения по намечаемой деятельности нового разреза Кузнецкий Южный. И на этих обсуждениях не обсуждалось строительство погрузочной станции. И жители, когда на общественных слушаниях спросили, почему погрузочную станцию не включили, им было отвечено, что по ней будут отдельные слушания. Все мы ждали этих слушаний, но слушаний не было. 9 мая 2020 года техника для строительства погрузочной станции вошла мимо этого поселка, проехали под железнодорожным мостом. Это было сделано ночью, втайне от жителей, втайне от всех. Ночью также они уже сняли плодородный слой почвы, начали строительство погрузочной станции. Жители обращались в полицию. Полиции было показано разрешение на строительство. Это разрешение было выписано главным архитектором Кемеровской области. Полиция уже не проверяла законность этого разрешения. Раз оно было, то им было позволено строить. И жители вначале не знали, что делать. Начали сначала искать нарушения при проезде через реку под мостом. В эту реку был размещен шлак для того, чтобы легче проезжать по дну реки, чтобы она была не такой глубокой. Мы писали многочисленные жалобы во все инстанции, во Росприроднадзор. И вот Росприроднадзор дал ответ недавно о том, что никаких нарушений нет. И вообще этот шлак прошел экспертизу, он безвредный. Хотя, в принципе, он металлургический шлак, мы сами измеряли, он радиоактивный, и людям даже становилось плохо. И 14 июня жители преградили путь техники с собой. Ну, техника была вынуждена остановиться, ну, так как жители возмущались, и полиция тоже должна была успокоить это возмущение. И жителям сказали, теперь будем разбираться. Сами представители разреза везде в средствах массовой информации и везде жителям также утверждали, что с документами все в порядке. Документы они показывать все полностью отказывались, но затем, когда это началось противостояние, начали приносить документы. Оказалось, что нет плана рекультивации земель. Этот план рекультивации был в спешке сделан, подписан уже 16 июня, уже после того, как технику остановили. Этот факт, что отсутствие плана рекультивации и послужил формальным основанием для отмены строительства углепогрузочной станции. Ну, в общем, люди в июне, 14 июня, после того, как техника была остановлена, разбили палаточный лагерь. Так прошло 2 месяца. В течение этих 2 месяцев, с июня по август, люди ждали, что к ним приедет губернатор Кемеровской области. Именно губернатор обещал людям, что как решат люди, так и будет. Утром 13 августа, в 5 утра, внезапно техника снова начала работу. Приехала Федерация рукопашного боя. Машина встала на подъезде к посту Черемза и не пускала наших. Был объявлен клич по всем чатам, люди начали друг другу звонить, с утра там начали собираться люди. До этого там уже были поставлены столбы, рабочие в масках начали делать забор высокий. Люди вставали возле столбов и не давали прикручивать забор. Кто-то своими телами загораживал. Полиция вначале просто снимала на камеру все, что происходит, ничего не вмешивалось вообще. Потом нас, активистов, вызвал прокурор. Несколько человек приехали к нему на встречу. Ну, они объяснили ему ситуацию, что не согласны со строительством забора, погрузки, так как земли здесь сельхозназначения. Он сказал, я через 2 часа разберусь с этим. То есть как раз ожидали приезд прокурора, но вместо этого приехало несколько автобусов, полных вооруженного ОМОНа, Росгвардия еще приезжала, полиция в шлемах против безоружных людей. Задержали 3 людей. Один из них инвалид, один пожилой человек, ну и тоже женщина немолодая. Забор был прибит в присутствии ОМОНа. Погрузка отменена была 21 августа, но мы ожидаем, что не будет возобновлено это строительство. На помощь к угольщикам приехал блогер Артем Павличко. Всячески пытался спровоцировать, выискать какие-то неудобные моменты и продвигать такую позицию, что вот здесь собрались экотеррористы, которые вымогают деньги у разреза. Ходили слухи о том, что те, кто сейчас на Черемзе, когда это все закончится, на них будут заведены уголовные дела. И действительно получилось так, что это закончилось все, но сейчас идет преследование. Журналиста Вячеслава Кречетова обвинили в том, что он был организатором публичного мероприятия. Его вначале задержали на 2 суток, назначили штраф 20 тысяч рублей. В данный момент техника находится на строительной площадке. Работы не ведутся, так как строительство погрузочной станции отменено. Сейчас закончатся суды, и, видимо, там они уже либо окончательно оттуда уйдут, либо, может быть, вдруг начнут что-то делать опять, и тогда уже люди опять могут собраться. Вагончик у нас уже был, то есть мы его сейчас убрали, но мы показали, что если нужно, мы его поставим.
La geografía de Guatemala es bastante interesante en su dinámica y en su estructura completa, digamos, porque son tierras puramente forestales. Entonces, hay una serie de composición geográfica bien interesante, en donde se delimitan volcanes, sierras, muchas montañas. Y San Mateo Ixtatán es un punto dentro de toda una cordillera, que es la cordillera de los Cuchumatanes. Es una sierra que inicia desde México, termina hasta la parte de Izabal, casi que del otro lado de Guatemala. Es una sierra enorme, es una sierra grande, hay mucho mineral, hay mucha captación de agua, hay abundancia de ríos, abundancia de nacimientos. Y el mineral, que no lo han empezado a explotar como tal el mineral de precioso, pero sí el agua está visto como un generador de un flujo económico. Son tierras que a lo largo de la historia han sido habitadas por estos pueblos mayas, específicamente por el pueblo Chuj, el pueblo Canjoal. Han sido zonas que durante nuestra historia han sido despojadas 1, 2, 3 veces. Nuestros abuelos y nuestras abuelas han tenido que comprar 1, 2, 3 veces su tierra y actualmente este sería el cuarto despojo de tierras dentro de nuestro territorio porque estos megaproyectos que se están dando a nivel nacional, aunque se llamen sostenibles, como en San Mateo Ixtatán es lo que vende la empresa, que es un proyecto sostenible, un proyecto verde, que va a producir energía limpia. Aunque sea visto desde ese concepto occidental, sigue siendo perjudicial para los pueblos mayas. Hay una presión enorme en el territorio sobre este sistema que está funcionando en Guatemala, que es el sistema capitalista, que tiene muchos lazos entre el Estado de Guatemala, el gobierno y estas empresas privadas que buscan es explotar. Hay un proceso, como son a una gran escala, que tiene que realizar cambios fuertes en la tierra, digamos. Se construyen grandes obras para poder captar el agua que viene de los ríos y eso genera, en principio, un daño directo al área en donde tienen la ubicación geográfica. Segundo, es un daño a las comunidades que están río abajo, porque como se capta el agua, ya las comunidades las dejan sin agua. Específicamente en San Mateo Ixtatán se empieza a dar la problemática hace alrededor de 10 años, pero hay una relación que se tiene entre Santa Cruz Barías, que es otro lugar cercano de ahí, en donde inicia, ahí comienza, digamos, toda la operación de la inversión española para la construcción de las hidroeléctricas. Es en Santa Cruz Barías, años antes, en el 2008, empezaba la compra de los terrenos a los comunitarios, a los productores locales. Es en donde empieza ya la compra por medio de sobornos, por medio de mentiras hacia a las personas para que vendieran su tierra. Entonces es en donde ya empieza a haber los rumores de que se va a instalar hidroeléctricas en el territorio. En Santa Cruz Barías se ubica la empresa Hidro Santa Cruz, que es una empresa que está subsidiada por una empresa española que se llama Hidralia Energía S.A. Tuvieron mucha persecución de personas que no vendían, que no querían vender su tierra, las persiguieron. Hablando de Santa Cruz Barías, porque es en donde inicia este proceso, donde ya después entra San Mateo Ixtatán en los proyectos hidroeléctricos Pojom 1 y Pojom 2. Es lo que es como ellos presentan el proyecto y hace que tengan el financiamiento de bancos internacionales. Dentro de estos bancos está el Banco Mundial, el Banco Interamericano de Desarrollo, hay una banca española y en San Mateo Ixtatán, pues estas entidades como el Ministerio de Ambiente han jugado un papel importante, pero no para los pueblos, importante para las empresas, porque no ponen ninguna justificación, no ponen ningún pero para aprobar y decir adelante, ejecútenlo, sin ninguna consideración, sin nada de intermedio en la población, ¿verdad? Sin respetar las consultas comunitarias que se han realizado en los territorios. En San Mateo Ixtatán se han realizado consultas comunitarias para ver si la gente está de acuerdo o no y han dicho claramente que no están de acuerdo, pero aún así se siguen ejecutando. Esto va de la mano con la presencia militar que el gobierno instala en el territorio. Son mecanismos que utilizan para represión al pueblo, para mantener al pueblo sumiso ante las acciones que han hecho. Entonces, sí, efectivamente el ejército sirve para está al servicio de los empresarios, está protegiéndolos a toda costa, pues porque son ellos los que están generando riqueza económica y tienen esa capacidad de comprar. La resistencia pacífica de Ixquisis está estructurada por personas, hombres, mujeres, abuelos, abuelas, que están pidiendo el reconocimiento de sus derechos, el que se valore la vida como algo principal, un derecho principal y fundamental para el buen vivir de los pueblos. Son personas que lo único que buscan es la estabilidad de su comunidad. Ellos no están en contra del desarrollo. Y hay un respeto que debe de haber hacia las comunidades que nunca se va a dar, porque todo el recurso económico se lo llevan ellos y nada se queda aquí. Entonces la resistencia pacífica de Ixquisis son comunidades que están en contra de estos proyectos mineros y que de forma pacífica, sin armas, sin ningún tipo violento, porque eso es lo que han dicho los noticieros en Guatemala, que son grupos violentos, son grupos de exguerrilleros, así les han dicho que son exguerrilleros, que también las han llamado como terroristas, como vándalos. La resistencia pacífica de Ixquisis pues lo único que busca es poder conservar sus bosques, es poder conservar el agua, es poder conservar su tierra, es poder conservar sus orígenes, su identidad como mayas, en donde han habido criminalizados, han ido personas a la cárcel por defender su río. La intimidación es algo que sufren estos defensores de los derechos humanos. Es una situación dura la que pueden tener, digamos, a la hora de tener intimidaciones, porque son intimidaciones de muerte, son intimidaciones de hasta los familiares salen afectados, porque como los tachan de vándalos, como los tachan de lo peor, entonces eso genera que ellos reciban todo tipo de críticas y eso hace que vulnere tanto su seguridad personal como familiar. El riesgo principal de un defensor de los derechos humanos es la muerte. Es que el simple hecho de que uno defienda su tierra, su agua, te convierte en un defensor, pero también te convierte en un blanco de muerte. Por ejemplo, este año, solo lo que llevamos de este año, con esta situación de la pandemia del coronavirus, han muerto 18 personas defensoras de los derechos humanos. No específicamente en San Mateo, sino a nivel nacional. El Estado no está para proteger a los derechos humanos, no está para proteger a los defensores de los derechos. O sea que sí hay un riesgo alto, una amenaza grande de muerte hacia las personas que defienden su territorio. Entonces no hay importancia. La vida aquí en Guatemala y en Centroamérica, diría yo, no vale. No vale el ser defensor. Mañana te pueden matar, todo queda en impunidad, no hay investigación. Seguimos estando en un estado feudal, no hemos cambiado. O sea, lo único es que ahora te dicen que tenés derechos y que puedes vivir libre, pero no es así en realidad. O sea, si uno se pone en la defensa de los derechos humanos, es muy probable y con una alta posibilidad de que mañana o pasado ya no estés. Actualmente las empresas siguen en funcionamiento. Hubo un proceso de militarización del territorio fuerte. Pusieron un destacamento militar en el lugar, en Ixquisis, y eso permitió apaciguar la lucha que tenían las comunidades ahí en contra de la hidroeléctrica. El gobierno, la única apertura que da es al diálogo. Es una estrategia que utilizan para desarticular también y para identificar liderazgos. Una apuesta bastante interesante de pasar de la resistencia organizativa a una propuesta política, en donde los pueblos puedan entrar a administrar los bienes y recursos naturales desde el Estado, desde el gobierno. La propuesta es, en principio, que no se lleven a cabo estos proyectos. Como comunidades y pueblos originarios, no queremos que se lleven a cabo este tipo de proyectos porque no hay ningún beneficio para las comunidades. Es un no a estos megaproyectos, a estas industrias, porque el planteamiento se puede dar de diferente forma. Por ejemplo, otra comunidad en otro lugar, la misma comunidad tiene su microhidroeléctrica. Tenemos esa concepción de vida que no está lejos de nuestra madre tierra, digamos. Existe esa relación fuerte entre el bienestar de la naturaleza y el bienestar de nosotros. Es algo que nos identifica como mayas y que lo hemos conservado durante mucho tiempo. Y lo único que queremos es armonía entre la naturaleza y nosotros, porque la respetamos mucho, sabemos que nuestros principios y valores están para el cuidado de la naturaleza.
The Philippines is actually an archipelagic country. We have so much natural resources. We have one of the most biodiverse country in the world. And as I said, Palawan is is unique because it's one of the remaining island that's been untouched by large-scale plunder or the environmental devastation. That's the uniqueness of Palawan province. And also the communities, particularly indigenous people communities in Palawan, are still closely integrated within the ecosystem. Historically, environmental conflict in the Philippines started centuries ago when the Spanish colonized us. They started to open up our forests to establish plantations. Then in 1900s, when they were defeated by the Americans, it was the Americans who commercialized our natural resources. For example, our forests, our minerals, agricultural lands, and water resources have been opened up. This trend continues even after we have this so-called nominal independence from the U.S. But the policy of export-oriented and import-dependent economy was imposed on us. We reach what we call an environmental crisis when we have lost around more than 50% or around 50% of our forest cover. There are different illegal activities happening in Palawan. Illegal logging, wildlife trading, illegal land conversion. But at the same time, legal activities like large-scale mining, ecotourism, agroplantations are the primary causes of environmental degradation in Palawan, and not only in Palawan, in the whole Philippines. There's a operation of a large-scale mining which is owned by Japanese corporation Sumitomo. It has been operating in Palawan for more than 20 years. And then they are the primary producer of nickel in the Philippines. They are located inside virgin forest or regional forest, and they are the primary cause of forest degradation in that part, no, southern part of Palawan. There are three important things on large-scale mining. First, even before COVID, does not contribute significantly to the national economy. It only employs less than 1% of the labor force, contribute to the gross domestic product less than 1%. It gave so little tax to the government, so it doesn't have a significant contribution to the economy. Mining operation create a lot of environmental destruction. Second, large-scale mining is the primary cause of human rights violations among environmental defenders in the Philippines. Third, it's been unpopular, and a lot of communities in the Philippines are opposing large-scale mining operations, particularly in Palawan. The environmental defenders are the common people, particularly the indigenous people, the peasants, even the workers. Or one of the biggest sector being affected by human rights violation are forest rangers, government employees, those on the ground actually protecting different ecosystems. Based on our monitoring, around 80 to 90% of the victims of human rights violation, particularly on killings, comes from the sector of indigenous people and peasants. So they are the most vulnerable sector to human rights violation while they are doing their responsibility to protect our ecosystem, defend their communities, and asserting their rights. During the administration of Duterte, it's become one of his economic priority, the establishment and expansion of agricultural plantations, particularly palm oil plantation, where this new plantation will get their land. And obviously, it's the remaining forest areas being guarded by these forest rangers, being guarded by indigenous people. There's a conflicting directives from the government itself, because the DNR, the Department of Environment and Natural Resources tasked to protect the forest, particularly, and they employ forest rangers to do that. But they also, the DNR, give permits or recommend the opening of areas for establishment of this commercial plantation that will encroach or converting these forest areas. So that's the conflict. On June 10, 2020, the DNR officials and employees are checking about illegal cutting, harvesting of forest products, particularly mangrove trees in the area. Police Colonel Marion Balolong, Philippine National Police Chief of that city, ordered them to be arrested. And during the arrest, they were physically abused and threatened by the police chief. Authorities found out later on that Police Colonel Marion Balolong has a personal interest for claiming that the area belongs to him. Sadly, we've been monitoring human rights violation among environmental defenders since 2001. And we have a pretty good monitoring of incidents of killings among environmental defenders. And looking our data from 2001 to 2019, we found that around 70% of the perpetrators of these killings are state forces, suspected coming from the armed forces of the Philippines, their agents, and the Philippine National Police. Why is this? Because the government have this national policy. They established the Investment Defense Force. So the Investment Defense Force will allow the regular forces of the military to be hired as security forces of a private corporation. It's funny, the government is the one who are protecting these environmental criminals like the big minings. And it's not only being used to protect the operation of the corporation, but also they're being used to silence, to stifle the resistance and opposition of communities. Even it's a peaceful protest, it's a legal movement. Police and military are being used to harass, threat, and stop this community and forcefully convince them to accept the projects of the government. And recently, Philippine government passed the anti-terrorism law, which we think is more of a terror law for us, because those who are dissenting to the government can be easily arrested, detained. By mere suspicion, they are a suspected terrorist, even though they are doing legitimate advocacy.
We resist as one planet because we have a better world to win.
Like us, we are part of a people's organization, a national network. Last year until now, we are being continued to be harassed by police forces. So they're still continuing to have a surveillance on our national office or our headquarters. Last year, we are threatened with the police raid by the Philippine National Police. We are being red tagged. Red tag means that the government, particularly the armed forces of the Philippines, openly and publicly accusing us as a front of the communist rebels. You expect the police, the government to protect you or support you on your advocacy, but they are the ones who are threatening you and stopping you to do your work, do your advocacy. From 2001 to May 2020, there's an increasing human rights violation, particularly on the case of killings. 2019 was the worst year for us, or I think 2018. But right now, the killings do not stop. And our last monitoring, there were around 20,000 environmental defenders who suffered different or victimized by different human rights violations. So they're being harassed, detained, illegally arrested, red tag, some of them were killed. Violent nature of the state, of the government, does not show its strength, it shows weakness. While we are the most dangerous country in Asia for environmental defenders, the Philippines also has the most strong people's movement, environmental movement in the region. Our people, the indigenous people, the peasants, and the different sectors have so much lessons and victories in their resistance against destructive projects, whether it's from foreign corporation or local landlords or big business. And the solution to this environmental conflict is for us to continue our fight. Civil society should have a strong link with the communities in their struggle to protect their environment, land, and asserting their rights. While we are doing a particular resistance, particular project, we are also working for establishment of a new society in the Philippines where the government will truly protect its people and its environment.
Para nós, povos indígenas, a floresta amazônica, mãe natureza, é nossa mãe, faz parte de nós. Tudo está interligado nessa casa comum. Não é apenas a floresta, não é apenas os rios, não é apenas os animais, faz parte de nós. E todos, assim como indígenas, assim como os quilombolas, assim como os ribeirinhos, assim como os brasileiros, assim como todos nesse planeta, nós necessitamos dela. É fonte de vida e respiração. A gente começa dizendo como a fala dos povos indígenas, né? É o capitalismo agressivo, o capitalismo que mata, o capitalismo, o agronegócio que vem matando muitos povos indígenas, fazendeiros que têm desmatado. O agronegócio, quando atinge as terras indígenas, vão cortando árvores, desmatando florestas também. As madeireiras ilegais também, aqui no Brasil, aqui na Amazônia. E não esquecendo, aqui na parte norte do Brasil, no estado de Roraima, entre o Amazonas, tem a mineração ilegal, garimpo ilegal em territórios indígenas, garimpeiros adentrando as comunidades indígenas. Principalmente em um tempo que a gente está vivendo agora, em tempo de pandemia, mais de 20 mil garimpeiros em território Yanomami aqui. E é uma preocupação muito grande, porque aqui no estado de Roraima, quem foi o primeiro indígena a morrer foi em Yanomami. Como é que essa doença chegou até lá? Os povos estão vulneráveis a essa situação, com a entrada de garimpeiros em seus territórios, eles ficam vulneráveis. Ah, aqui tem muito, tem, aqui no Brasil tem, nós temos muitos defensores. Nós, a gente sempre inicia pelos guardiões da floresta, né? Os povos indígenas que defendem seus territórios e a natureza com unhas de dente, porque nós somos natureza. Mas tem surgido vários defensores do meio ambiente aqui. Nós temos várias instituições que têm trabalhado em defesa à natureza, à Amazônia, o ISA, Instituto Socioambiental, o Conselho Indigenista Missionário, várias instituições e atores brasileiros também, todos em prol da Amazônia, todos em prol da casa comum, da nossa casa, porque a luta é de todos. Quem defende o povo, quem defende a natureza, são ameaçados de morte. Nós estamos vivendo um tempo muito difícil aqui no estado de Roraima, em todo lugar do mundo e no Brasil, principalmente para as populações indígenas, que se encontram em vulnerabilidade. Nós perdemos muitas lideranças indígenas no ano 2020. Nós perdemos grandes pajés, xamãs, anciãos, o ancião tem uma importância muito grande para nós. Os povos indígenas vivem da cultura da oralidade, da fala. E quando morre um ancião, um velho, um pajé, morre uma biblioteca, morre conhecimentos. E é por isso que eles cuidam muito dos anciãos. A pandemia veio para matar e adentrou nas todas as comunidades indígenas. E muitos parentes indígenas, povos, nações estão morrendo com isso. E esse ano a gente vem sofrendo vários ataques, né? Ataques de direito mesmo, por parte do governo aqui no Brasil. Mas eu posso dizer que, mediante o tempo que a gente vive, atualmente a gente vive um dos os piores governos em relação à defesa dos povos indígenas. Um governo que não houve, que não há políticas públicas para indígenas, que menospreza suas falas, que não houve. E a gente vive o pior ano, que não há demarcação para territórios indígenas. A própria fala do presidente atual do Brasil, Jair Bolsonaro, fala que não vai dar terra para índios. Isso é uma preocupação muito grande. Desse ano, nós tivemos várias mortes de lideranças indígenas no Brasil. E é uma preocupação muito grande para nós, como indígena, aqui no Brasil. É um próprio governo racista, genocida, que fala que vai passar por cima e passa mesmo. Assim como ele fala, tem várias pessoas vindo com ele, que tem racismo, que tem com esse pensamento de desmatar a natureza, de acabar com o verde, de acabar com vidas. Nós dizemos que o grande mentor nisso é o atual presidente genocida e racista que há no Brasil atualmente, Jair Bolsonaro. Desde sempre, os povos indígenas sempre protegeram suas casas. Eles têm suas formas de proteção. Os ancestrais têm nos guiado até aqui, com as suas formas de plantação, de cultivo, de cuidado, sem desmatar, sem violentar a natureza, cultivar, produzir, cuidar de animais, sem desmatar, sem queimar a sua casa, a floresta. Eu tenho pensado bastante, né, o que poderia parar esses ataques. Mas o ser humano, ele está sempre em construção. A gente acredita muito que o ser humano possa mudar um dia, né? Mas eu acredito muito na esperança mesmo, porque nós vivemos tempos muito difíceis. Em todos os cantos do Brasil, posso olhar realmente que a natureza, ela faz parte, ela nos deixa protegida, ela nos combate contra tudo que está acontecendo. E quando olhar para essa natureza, nós somos parte da natureza.
Thank you very much for watching. While having all these 10 interviews with the storytellers, we all agreed that the first step to solving any problem is to recognize there is one. Environmental conflicts are a big issue, and environmental protection is not a crime. See you very soon. Paka paka.